Praise the Lord, everybody.
Praise the Lord.
This morning, I'm just going to speak on five little points that will try to help make marriage successful.
Amen.
There's a lot more than 5 points, but I'm just going to focus on 5 points.
Right.
I'm first going to read from Genesis 1:28. So God blessed the man and the woman and said to them, "Be fruitful and increase in number. Fill the earth and subdue it." This states the ideal relationship is marriage of a man and a woman lifelong with the goal of having children. In Matthew 19, 4-6, Jesus said that at the beginning, your Creator made them male and female and said, "For this reason, a man will leave his father and mother and be united to his wife, and the two will become one flesh. So they are no longer two, but one." Jesus then added, "Therefore, what God has joined together, let no man separate."
Yes.
Interestingly, in the next text, in the section, Jesus focuses on children. In Matthew 19:14, says, "Let the little children come to me. Do not hinder them, for the kingdom of heaven belongs to such as these." So the very first point I'm going to speak on is listening. Everyone should be quick to listen, slow to speak, and slow to anger.
Amen.
It's in James 1:19. God gave us 2 ears and 1 mouth, but one would hardly know it. We are so anxious to talk that we are frequently getting our next thoughts together without even listening carefully to what's being said to us. We jump in with what we have to say, and we fail to listen. I'm sure many of us in relationships can all understand that.
Amen.
For us, women in particular, having someone to speak to is important for us. When the husband comes home at night from work, we want to talk about our day. Not just one part of our day, but every bit of our day. The husband is often tired and is tuned out. Yet, in the process of listening, which can begin very simply by asking a question, "How was your day?" that is an important part of a relationship. When a couple fails to hear each other or talk to each other, they will tend to grow apart.
Mm.
Thus, it is as critical every day to engage in conversation. It is one sign of love for one another. It's funny how us women feel the need to share what happened throughout our day, but the men don't need to unload like us. When we are doing marriage counseling, we cannot stress enough how important it is to listen to each other, as listening to each other keeps the lines of communication open.
Yes.
Because when they're closed, then it's hard to get our life back on track. We tend to decide to give up instead.
Yeah.
And we all know that communication is a big part of a successful relationship and marriage. A lot of times in our marriage counseling, we speak about, you know, when we're trying to listen to each other and cutting each other off. And all of Pastor and I, a few marriage counseling, we say, you know, if you're having a hard time with your spouse listening to you or vice versa, why don't you just take a time out and say, "Okay, I want you to give me 5 minutes where you keep your mouth completely closed, let me speak, and then vice versa." I've never had to do that where maybe sometimes I should have, but I've known a few people that we have counseled that called me back and said that has worked wonders for them because they tend to be able to get their mindset on actually listening to their spouse for that complete, but once that buzzer goes off, she's like, "Okay, now we have to change right away." But at least you have that minimum amount of time where you know that your husband's focusing on you. That means no television running in the background, no cell phones handy. That means focusing 100% one on each other. Sometimes that's what we need, just to get us in the groove, and after that, we won't need a timer anymore. It's just going to come natural to us. God wants us to listen to Him, so it means the same thing with our spouses. We must listen to them, as well as our children. Second one is listening to God. Jesus said, "My sheep listen to my voice, and I know them, and they know me." It's in John 10:27. Similarly, it is all too easy to rush into a church and tell God what we need. God knows what we need even before we do. And God can provide it to us.
Amen.
But have you really listened to God? It's important to note that when Jesus gave the disciples what we know as the Lord's Prayer, it's funny as we were speaking on all that this morning.
Amen.
There are 3 petitions that start the prayer. First is, "Hallowed be thy name."
Mm-hmm.
Second is, "Thy kingdom come." And third is, "Thy will be done." Notice that these are the prayers for God. It is only after we pray these prayers that Jesus bids us to ask for prayers for ourselves, our daily need, our bread, forgiveness of our sins, and guidance in our way, which covers the essentials of our present, past, and future.
Amen.
God can guide us if we listen to God and discern God's will, and we pray for these three petitions for God in the Lord's Prayer. Then when we ask God for what concerns us, we can ask in a much better way, and that is more consistent with God's purpose in our life. As a new father, God does not grant everything that we ask for.
That's right.
Sometimes God grants us very little or even nothing at times. That's where we have to not be upset. We sit and we think that we're still waiting for him to answer.
Mm-hmm.
No is an answer.
That's right. Amen.
Even though we may not like to hear that no, sometimes that's what we need. God knows what we need. Do we know what we need? Or do we know what we want?
All right.
It's amazing if we only discern what God does for us, if we were only observant. You know, he does so much for us every day, but do we actually see what he does for us? We take it for granted. Oh, that was me. No, it wasn't. That was God.
That's right, preacher.
God doesn't know us. What we have to do is listen to God. One great way to do this in a marriage is to pray together with one spouse. And later, if there are children involved, to pray with their children. We say that families that pray together stay together. This is another point that we stress in counseling, is to pray together, and especially letting your children see you pray. As this is how we teach them, and how our children can learn from us what we are doing. Because if we're doing everything behind closed doors, what are the children learning from us? When we feel that we are struggling, we need to seek God and ask for his guidance. We need to listen as well for him to answer. And always keep the openness with our spouse.
Yes.
Not try to do things behind each other's backs, because that gets us in a lot of trouble. And sometimes it's not easy to do things behind our spouse's back, because we know that Christ in us, he's hitting on us saying, are you sure you want to do that?
Mm-hmm.
Are you sure you want to do that? No, we have to listen, not just listen to God, listen to each other. This is a hard one. Forgive each other.
Mm.
Bear with each other and forgive whatever grievances you may have against one another. Forgive as the Lord forgave you. And all of these things, virtues, put on love, which binds them all together in perfect harmony. As in Colossians 3:13-14. Forgiveness can be one of the hardest things that we have to do. And yet, without forgiveness, there can be no reconciliation when we do something wrong and hurt our spouse.
Mm.
Forgiveness starts with true repentance and admitting to that person that we have made a mistake, and ask for forgiveness. Ask for forgiveness from our spouse, and then ask for forgiveness from God, and ask him to show us the way to not do this over again.
Mm-hmm.
Granting forgiveness can be equally hard, but it's the only way. One of the ways in making forgiveness easier to do is to remember that God has forgiveness. God has forgiven much greater sins. But the two are linked. In order to get forgiveness from God, we must forgive others too.
Amen.
God's not going to forgive us if we can't forgive others. He's going to say, child, look in the mirror. And when we look in the mirror, we're not going to see him. We're going to see our mistakes.
Amen.
It would be so great if we could wake up in the morning and look in the mirror and see Jesus' reflection.
Wow.
None of us can.
Mm.
Forgiveness is a unique feature of Christianity. We must all remember to forgive. We are able to forgive others. How can a marriage survive? If we're not able to forgive others, how can a marriage survive? We all know that we all do things which we may not do intentionally.
Right.
But we must forgive. The more open and honest we are, the easier it is to forgive and to ask for forgiveness. Going through struggles with my husband and I. My husband has a hard time to say, I forgive you. He will show it to me, but he has a hard time saying, I forgive you. Does it make it wrong? No, because I know in him showing me that he's saying it.
Mm-hmm.
And I have to accept whatever way he's doing it, saying it to me, I must accept it that way.
Mm-hmm.
If I can freely say, I forgive you for your sins or whatever, and he accepts it that way, who am I to judge how he's forgiven me? And there are so many different ways we can show forgiveness and ask for forgiveness. It's not just by saying it and speaking it.
Amen.
Number four is submit to each other. Love and respect. Each of you also must love his wife as he loves himself, and the wife must respect her husband. That's in Ephesians 5:33. The home and the church are God-made fields in which submission may bloom. In the home, men must lead, and women must comprehensively encourage and welcome this leadership. Much more than one's felt needs, love, language, or personal preference, these are the most important words in the universe for building a God-glorifying marriage. The husband, like Christ, is the head of his wife. His wife recognizes the headship and responds graciously to it by following him. Just as the church does not rule or lead Jesus, but follows him all the way to glory.
Amen.
In counseling, we also stress the importance of love and respect. And we all know that the husband is the head of the household and that he sets the mood in the home. This is something we speak quite a bit on when we're doing counseling. When a husband comes home from work, if he's in a bad mood, well then you know the air in the room is going to be kind of gloomy. And if he comes home and he's in a real good mood, happy and smiling, well then the rest of the family follows in line.
Mm-hmm.
This goes again to listening. Because if we're actually seeing our spouses when we come home, and we know that if we're in a bad mood, we're going to set the children in a bad mood, everyone, we need to not hide it, but put it away and go off our day. And then later on, then we need to discuss it. But for the homes that have children, you know, we need to go ahead and, you know, come home in a good mood, give your wife a kiss, always give a kiss goodbye, kiss good morning, never go to bed with anything hindering our relationship.
Right.
Because our children are seeing what we are doing. And if we want to be teachers, because we all are teachers with our children during our relationships, we need to let them see how we can discuss openly, forgive openly, teach openly.
Amen. Amen. Amen.
No, when it says that we have to submit to each other, submitting is doing day-to-day things.
Mm-hmm.
I have an example of some of my family members always saying, like, why do you never want to come out for supper with us? Why do you always say you have to go home and make supper for your family? When God joins a man and woman together, we become family. Our other family, still our family. My job as a spouse, as a helpmate of my husband, is to make sure that the house is in perfect condition. Well, not perfect, because we know we all know it's perfect, but in running order. So my duty as a wife is to prepare the meal for my family on a daily basis.
Mm-hmm.
Easy for everybody else to say, well, why do you have to do that? We don't do it. You don't have a covenant with God either. God, and we unite each other in marriage, we were saying that we are putting ourselves first.
Yes.
Everybody else comes behind us.
That's right.
If I can't make my house a happy home, nobody's going to be able to do it for me.
No.
That's right.
If we want a happy home, we have to work at it through listening. Through listening to what God says. Through teachings.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's easy for those who aren't married to point a finger and say, well, you don't have to do that.
That's right.
No, I don't have to do that.
And what to do.
But if I want my relationship to work, I want to do it.
Yes.
And why do I want to do it? Because I want a happy spouse.
And,
you know, I want to please my husband. Just like when he does certain things, he wants to please me.
Mm-hmm.
Whether it being bringing a bouquet of flowers home, what's the occasion? I love you.
Amen.
What a blessed occasion is that?
Mm-hmm.
Or your favorite chocolate bar. I don't eat chocolate, but once in a while I'll get a chocolate bar. Well, I know you like these, and they had them for sale, and I thought of you.
Yes.
Thank you.
Yes.
You know, just these little things that make us submit to each other. You know, actually, that's submitting.
That's
it. You're giving. You know, submitting is not just in the bedroom.
That's
you know,
right.
Submitting is on everything that we do. We do together.
You better
as
teach.
Amen.
Teach, Pastor.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen.
And the last point is teach the next generation.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
Deuteronomy 6:4-7. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God. The Lord is one love.
Yes.
The Lord your God, with all, love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your strength. Mm-hmm. These commandments that I give to you today are to be upon your hearts. Impress them on your children. Talk about them when you sit at home with them, when you take a walk along the road with them, mm-hmm. when you lie down with them, and when you get up in the morning with them.
That's right.
In the years past, fathers and mothers would pray with their children, and often at the dinner table would discuss some aspects of the Bible, reading the Bible with the children. How many families still do that today?
Wow. Mm-hmm.
I don't know that many of them do. I remember my grandmother, we always called her the church lady because everything was like really strict, and she was the organist, and when we went to church, there was no shutting her eyes, stood up straight, keep your mouth shut. And it was like, oh my goodness, what is this? Are you going to military school here? But that's how she was. No, we don't wear pants. You never saw a woman wearing pants back.
That's right.
And it had to be a skirt or a dress below the knee. Mm-hmm. It's like, wow.
Decency.
Decency is exactly what it was. Things haven't changed that much today. Mm. We just choose to do it differently.
Yes.
But if we get back to what it was in the past, sitting around the supper table, I remember sitting around the supper table at home, and we didn't talk. That was the news playing in the background, and we didn't talk.
Wow.
In our home growing up, with my children, that was where we shared.
Mm-hmm.
You got around the supper table, okay, how was your school day? How was your math test? Did you have to go to detention today? That's where we have to show that we're open. And,
yes.
How many other times do we get where we're with our family and we can sit around a table, everyone together,
mm-hmm.
and actually communicate as a family?
That's right.
It's around the supper table because that's where everybody wants to be because everybody wants to eat. So as we're eating, it's time to share. Many of us don't do that anymore. We need to get back to this. We need to do Bible studies with our children mm-hmm. and our spouses so we know how to grow together as a family.
Yes.
In God's eyes, not in our ways.
Mm-hmm.
When one does that, it's amazing the result that it can have. Teaching the next generation through Bible study is one of the most important things that we can do. It is one of the few things that a parent should insist upon. As we all know, there are many families that go to church and the children stay home.
Mm-hmm.
I know a lot of times my children would prefer to stay home. They say, I don't listen. I go to church, I don't listen anyway. Then you have 15 years later when my daughter comes up to me and says, somebody did something. And she says, and I remember back when we were sitting in church what Pastor David said. Mm-hmm. And she was able to tell that person something. Are you telling me that you actually listened when you came to church?
Mm-hmm.
Well, it's kind of hard not to. We were sitting there. But we think that they don't want to come. It's because our generation is lazy.
Mm. My God.
That's the truth.
They prefer to stay home and be on the computer, on their cell phones or whatever.
Yes.
It's not much to I made my children come to church with me.
Yes.
No, you're coming to church. What's 2 hours out of your day on a Sunday to spend with mom at a service?
That's right.
It's nothing. And I know now, from all the 4 children that have come here, they're all able to help somebody with the word of Christ when need.
Mm-hmm.
Just Nikki was working with a lady, and she says, what would Sissy say? She thought that, and then she told the lady something. And then the lady says, well, now I need to know how to ask her to write me a prayer for people who are persecuting me.
Wow.
And he says, I'll ask her because I don't know what to respond to you. So I just told her, read, I think it was Psalm 69. I said, that's all about persecution. I said, tell her that, Nicole. She doesn't realize that she's put in that position with that lady, not only to help take care of her, but she's helping, assisting her with the word of God.
That's it.
So she comes back and asks me questions.
And she's growing too.
So she's growing in Christ, whether she knows it or not.
Amen.
Amen.
So that's why it's so important that we need to teach our children.
Mm-hmm.
Because if we don't teach our children, who's going to teach them? Not the schools, because the schools are going to, they're going to teach them their mathematics and everything,
mm-hmm.
but they're not going to teach them on day-to-day living. That's where us as parents come into. That's where
right.
we need to be really obedient to God's word. so that we can teach our children as well. And by being able to God's word, it helps us in a relationship in our marriage on how to talk back and forth as well.
Amen.
And when we're struggling, what can we do to work through it? Sometimes we may be going through things and not knowing what to do. Coming to an elder into the church or even to a pastor and saying, you know, I'm struggling in this area. Where is it in the Bible that I can read that could help?
That's right.
Yes.
That's what we're all here for.
That's right.
Yes.
You know, we may not want anybody to know that we're struggling in our relationships at home. Because why? Do you think you're the only one that's struggling?
Come on,
I'm
now.
Sorry. Jerry and Lynn, you may struggle last week. Well, now I may be struggling this week.
Mm-hmm.
And next week and the week after.
Yeah, okay.
But if you know something that's going to be able to help me, why wouldn't you want to share?
Share
it. Vice versa.
Right.
That's what God's word is for, is to share so we can all have healing.
Yes,
if
amen.
We don't do it, we're all going to be stuck in our little ruts, and it's going to keep digger and deeper and deeper and deeper until there's no way out. And then we say, well, what are we going to do? How do we get out of this? Well, why didn't you come to me 6 months ago when you were going through it? Why were you holding on to that, what is that we call that? Pride?
Pride.
Yep.
Pride?
That's what it is.
Pride has... destructive. It destructs marriages.
Mm-hmm.
Destroys us. We let our pride get in the way. God says pride is one of the most dangerous sins there is.
Absolutely.
When you need help, ask for help. Mm-hmm. Same things when you need a seat. When you see a need, fill a need.
Same thing.
When you need help, ask for help.
Amen.
Yes.
It's not that hard to say, I'm struggling. Is there anything that you can help me with?
Amen.
Amen.
It's not that hard. Why is marriage important? Marriage is important because throughout the Bible, the marriage relationship between a husband and a wife is a metaphor for the relationship between Christ and
the church.
Throughout the Bible.
Mm-hmm.
In Jeremiah 3:32, God says, the time is coming when I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and the house of Judah. It will not be like a covenant I made with their forefathers when I took them by the hand and led them out of Egypt, because they broke my covenant, though I was a husband to them. Notice that God made a covenant with the people and then states that he was their husband, linking the covenant between God and his people to the marriage covenant between a man and a woman.
Mm-hmm.
In Revelation 19, the wedding of the Lamb, which is Jesus, has come, and his bride, the church, has made herself ready.
Amen.
In Ephesians 5:28-32, marriage is discussed in his way, the same way husbands ought to love their wives as their own bodies. He who loves his wife loves himself. After all, no one has ever hated his own body, but he feeds and cares for it, just as Christ does the church, for we are members of the body. For this reason, a man will leave his father and mother and be united to his wife, and the two shall become one flesh. You ever notice when we're in a marriage, when the pastor says everyone who was present at this wedding by responding, I do. You know, it's like when we, as a church, are responsible in a way to the marriages that we attend, because we are there to support, not just on the wedding day, but throughout their lives.
Yes.
A lot of people, when they come to things like that, to the wedding, they don't realize that they also have an obligation.
That's it.
To help. You know, we're saying, I do, up in front, but the congregation is in agreement, because when pastor says, is there anybody here who has any reason for these not to be joined together?
Yes.
And then speak now, whoever hold their peace.
Mm-hmm.
So it means we're in agreement.
Yes.
That's right.
So that no matter when we see something going on in a relationship, we need to reach out too.
Yes.
Even if we're told, mind your own business. I'm sorry, this is my business.
That's
because
right.
You are my business.
You are God's creation.
Yes,
we are part of the church.
Yes.
We are there to help.
Yes.
That's right. Amen.
It's just like when we're doing the baby dedications.
Mm-hmm.
We stand up and we ask the congregation, are you there to help?
That's right.
And we're all taking an oath, and we all say, I do.
I do.
So why is it we feel so afraid to reach out and help when we see somebody in need?
Mm.
What is it that's stopping us? Is it our pride? Because we're afraid to be told, this is none of your business?
Mm.
God made it our business.
Yes, he did.
So when we see something struggling, whether it be in a relationship with the children, with a marriage, no matter what, we need to step in. Because God has put us in that place to do so.
Amen.
Marriage is something that needs to be worked on daily, just as our commitment to God needs to be worked on daily. But it's the commitment that's worth working on.
Mm-hmm.
Now I'm going to end on my favorite Bible verse, which is the one we read this morning, 1 Corinthians 13, 14, 4 through 8. Love is patient and kind. Love is not jealous or boastful or proud or rude. It does not demand on its own way. It's not irritable, and it keeps no record of being wrong.
Mm.
It does not rejoice about injustice, but rejoices whenever the truth wins out. Love never gives up, never loses faith, is always hopeful, and endures throughout every circumstance. Prophecy and speaking is unknown languages, and special knowledge will become useless. But love will last forever. Love is the greatest gift that God has given to us.
Yes.
We shouldn't throw it away.
Jesus.
Now, that's something that we daily need to work on. Love one another as we want them to love us.
Amen.
That's not hard to do. Just remember, whenever we're going through things, what would Jesus do?
Mm-hmm.
And if we don't know the answer, ask somebody for help.
Exactly.
There's always somebody there that's willing to help, as long as you're willing to take that step.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you very much.
Amen. Woo-hoo!